computational measures instead of just talking about it, basically. So I'd just like to say thanks to my collaborator. So he's the person who kind of came up with this idea, because he's from the US, and I'm going to talk about gerrymandering in the US, but it does also happen in the UK. My background and what I do normally has very little to do with political science. So I mainly do computational cognitive modeling, but I'm going to talk to you today about something completely different. So my talk consists of two parts. The first part is going to be about the scientific findings of the project, and the second part is going to be about how I did it, so what I had to learn and what websites and tools and communities I interacted with along the way, because obviously this is a dramatically different area of research than what I normally do. So what is gerrymandering? In the broadest sense of the word, gerrymandering is affecting the political makeup of an area by, for example, drawing convoluted lines in order for the incumbents to retain their positions. So for example, this is an electoral district and it's been drawn in a specific way to ensure that Elbridge Gerry wins. And because this Elbridge Gerry was involved in drawing this very convoluted district, people thought it looked like a salamander. I don't know why a salamander has wings, but they thought it looked like a salamander, so they called it a gerrymander, and that name kind of stuck. So yeah, it's obviously a form of corruption, because you bypass political candidate that the majority of people want, and instead manage to change the results of an election by redrawing these lines. And quite often, as you can see in this example, you end up with a very complex shape when you look at the electoral districts on the map. Here are some toy examples to show you that it's not always about a complex shape, but obviously in some cases it is. So in the top toy example, this state has five districts, and each district is represented very appropriately. So this district is has a yellow party voters, and the result of their vote is that the yellow candidate wins that district, and the same obviously for all the others. So each district is properly represented. In this case, it's still relatively simple shapes, but in every case, the purple voters are the majority. So the people who vote for the yellow party never have a representative. And in the last case, these three districts are drawn in such a way that the yellow party wins 3 out of 5, because in these two the purple party wins, and overall for the whole state there's 3 representatives of the yellow that belong to the yellow party and 2 representatives that belong to the purple party, which is completely the opposite case to here. And as you can obviously see, 3 yellow wins versus 2 purple wins does not really represent what's actually going on with the population. Most of the people support the purple party. So there's various different ways that you can gerrymander a map. In the US, where most of the gerrymandering that I'm going to talk about, or all of it pretty much that I'm going to talk about, happens in the US. In the US, in 17 of the Republican-controlled states, they have 72% of the seats, but only 52% of the vote. So only 52% of the people voted for Republican, but they ended up controlling a much larger amount of seats. And the same is true for Democrats. So Democrats are the majority in 6 states, they control 71% of the seats but only 56% of the vote. So it's a real problem with their whole system. So you might think that one party has worse views than the other, but regardless, it's something that happens just as a byproduct of the way their system works. So they redraw their maps every 10 years. So every 10 years they get a chance, whoever's in power gets a chance to influence the outcome of the vote in a corrupt way. So another example to show how damaging this system can be is Obama in 2000 lost in Illinois, and his opponent, who won, was allowed to redraw the electoral district. And what he did was, he redrew it in such a way, by drawing this complex shape, that Obama's house wasn't in that district anymore. So he couldn't run again. Obviously Obama went off and did other things, but that obviously this is a very corrupt practice and can affect the results of elections. So, what I propose, and others have proposed, is that instead of allowing people to redraw the maps, people should debate the criteria for drawing the lines, so the criteria for creating the maps, and then discuss which of the many criteria are appropriate. Or they can have a lot of criteria and draw lots of maps and then debate the maps, as opposed to the people who are in charge being allowed to draw any maps they want. So the computers can take over the line drawing based on criteria that people decide on, and people don't have to draw anything anymore. So that's definitely a way to shift the debate to something more constructive. And in such a system, because the data and the code can be completely open source and open data, you don't you can have anyone checking that the process is what is done is what is on the tin. And also, obviously, computers don't get tired, so you can task computers and ask them to build to draw thousands of maps for people to discuss. So one of the main reasons why you want to remove people from this process, not just corruption, but also because people make mistakes and they get confused. And they specifically have issues with understanding where things are on maps. So for example, people think that Reno is east of LA. So that predominantly they think it's east of LA. Obviously it's west of LA, but they should think maybe it's sort of the same, east to west. And the same with Atlanta. People think Atlanta is east of Detroit. It's west of Detroit. And also, they predominantly think that. So a more realistic account should be that it's sort of on the same east to west point. So people in general have problems understanding maps and geography in general. So I'm going to tell you the results, and then I'm going to sort of move back and tell you how we got there, just so I can go over the sort of scientific output of this project first. So what we found is that when we ran our algorithm on each state, we found that the improvement, so the how much our solution improved on what's there, was a function of the number of districts and the number of districts squared, which means that the more populous a state is, so the more districts a state has, the harder it is for people to draw maps, because they were consistently drawing, or have been consistently drawing, worse maps than the ones our algorithm came up with. And we found a 20% improvement per state on average, and we believe that it's very possible, due to the fact that there wasn't, every single state was essentially improved on by our algorithm. It seems that it might not just be that people purposefully draw bad maps, they just might not be able to draw good maps, because they just, the cognitive demands of the task are just too much for people. So This is an overview of our results. So the states are colored based on how much our algorithm has improved on them. So for example, Texas has seen a huge improvement, the map versus our solution. Our solution is a lot better. And then obviously there's other states here which have seen an improvement, but just not as great. And obviously a lot of those states that have a smaller improvement is because they have fewer districts, so they're easy to draw. Looking more specifically at some maps that our algorithm has come up with, on the top is Iowa. So this is the existing map, and this is the map that our algorithm came up with. Iowa is quite interesting because it's one of the very few states that has an independent commission that draws the maps. So they have a as much as possible, a fair process. And our algorithm came up with something pretty similar in terms of how it's splitting the districts up, but just obviously much smoother lines because it can deal with these finer line drawings. In the case of North Carolina, these are the two most populous cities. This city is split into three or four districts, the same with this one, so it's got basically lines meeting in the center of the city and splitting up sort of like a pizza or something. Our algorithm gives Charlotte two mainly urban districts of its own. I think Raleigh gets its own urban district and kind of a suburban district. So a much better representation than, for example, what's going on here, where you have the center of Charlotte with a district going all the way down here into the countryside. Some other examples, so Utah, these West Valley City and Salt Lake City, so these two cities at the top are assigned, West Valley City is assigned to this district that goes all the way down to the bottom of the map, and the other half of West Valley City is assigned to this district here. Our algorithm assigned them to their own urban district. And Provo is split between this district and this really big district here, and gets its own district in our algorithm solution. And a really interesting case is Tucson in Arizona. In the real map, it's split over three districts. This district goes all the way to the very top of the state, because obviously the people who live here have like nothing in common with the people who live here. And in our algorithm, it creates like a kind of donut. So Tucson gets its own urban district with a suburban rural district around it. And that district now is a complete rural district all on its own. And in the case of Nebraska, I think that's also quite an interesting thing. So what the people who drew the map of Nebraska tried to do is create an urban district for Omaha, a suburban district around it, and a very rural district. And our algorithm could pick up on that and try to essentially do the same thing, creating three urban, suburban, and rural districts around Omaha. So the kind of high-level idea of our results is that the larger a state is, the more our algorithm can improve on it. We believe in part is because it's very complex for people to draw these detailed maps and bear in mind that, you know, the districts have to have equal population roughly, and so on. So a lot of gerrymandering might just be accidental. And what's interesting is Arizona, so this state here, is the most improved state, so in some ways the worst state in the present. And Arizona is not, it's not like a very well-known state for being particularly bad, and yet it's the worst, it's the most gerrymandered according to our metric. So our proposal is that the political, legal, and academic debate should focus on the criteria for drawing the maps, and computers should do all the hard work in some ways, drawing all these maps for then the people to discuss. And obviously, open software and open data will allow for the whole process to be checked by pretty much anyone who has the skills to check that. So that's the end of part one. And in the next part, I'm going to talk to you about some of the things that I had to deal with along the way. So I'm not from the US. Brad is from the US, my collaborator, and his he had the main idea for this project. So I had to understand, why is the US the way that it is? Why are these things so bad? And why is their system so strange? And it really, really promotes gerrymandering. It's like the number one country in the world for this kind of gerrymandering. I also had to understand the area of research, because it's very different to the kind of research I do. It's sort of more political science-y, and obviously some maths, applied maths, so I can perform the redistricting and so on. And develop our own algorithm to create clusters, which I'll talk about now. So we used a very simple algorithm called k-means, and we modified it to have weights on the clusters. The reason you need to have weights on the clusters is that you can't have 1,000 people in one district and 1,000,000 people in another district. They need to be roughly equal in population, so when you vote, your vote counts for roughly the same thing. So we found a way of assigning weights to clusters based on how many items are currently in a cluster, so then people can be assigned to the nearest cluster that isn't full already. So the clusters end up having a similar population. So all this code is completely open source and on GitHub, and you can play around with it and probably improve it if you have a look at it. We also had to come up with the metric of improvement to figure out, is our algorithm actually doing something better than what's out there. So Brad came up with the idea of comparing the pairwise distances, so the how close people are inside a cluster. So if people are very far apart inside a district, then it's likely that that district is gerrymandered, because it's reaching out into the countryside to dilute, for example, the urban vote. So we can compare the pairwise distances of the clusters, so that's the computationally derived districts, versus the pairwise distances in the districts as they are in the real world. So to give an example of this, the improvement ratio for South Carolina would be calculated by the pairwise distances, the average pairwise distance between people in our solution, versus the average pairwise distances between people in the real world. So you can come up with this number, and you can do the same for Texas, for example. So Texas is more improved because in our solution, they're 60 kilometers. These are not the real numbers, they're just examples. But in our solution, it's 60 kilometers. In the world, it's 100 kilometers. So the improvement ratio for Texas is lower, which means Texas has improved more. So that's how we came up with these numbers to show the improvement for each state. And the code that applies this algorithm for the pairwise distances is also online, and that was quite a tough data crunching solution. I had to come with it was a tricky problem, because there's, I think, 11 million pairwise, 11 million data points, and I had to calculate the pairwise distances between them. And obviously that doesn't, it's a very computationally intense problem, so I had to really try and figure out how to do this before the universe ends, right? I have to do it in time to actually write about it. So that was quite tricky. That's all on GitHub too, and I wrote quite a lot about what I had to do to figure out how to solve this, so this is all open source, and maybe someone can learn that you shouldn't use Python doing this because Python will be too slow, and maybe you want to use Cython. I use like combination of C and Cython, so they're like slightly more, C is a slightly more low level language to Python, so it kind of runs faster and uses less memory. So a specific software and data challenge that I had to tackle quite early on is understanding the US Census Bureau geographic information system data and their API. So the US Census gathers data on essentially everyone who lives in the US every 10 years. And they use that information to then redraw the districts, because obviously populations, people move, or whatever, populations change, people have babies and so on. So they need to redraw the boundaries to make the populations in each district the same. And I needed to not only download this data, which is tough in some senses, because you need to figure out what to ask the API to give you, but also understand what it is that the API is giving me. I also needed to turn the equations for the k-means clustering into code, and as I said, 11 million census blocks. So census blocks are the smallest unit that the US Census Bureau gathers population data on, and I needed to figure out what to do with all of this data, because it was like so many gigabytes of data, and I needed to crunch a lot of numbers. So the specific part that I'm going to focus on in this talk, to show you a little example of a problem that I had to solve, Brad came up with the idea to create a website, and the website to have an interactive map on it, which is partially shown down here, but maybe I can show you it live as well. And he wanted also to collect data on if people prefer our districts or their current districts. And obviously I also needed to figure out how to share all the data that I used and the output. So all the, you know, assigning the blocks to the districts, I had to share all of these gigabytes of data, and I needed to figure out how to do that. So how I solve this is pretty much how I solve any problem these days. I asked people on Twitter, and they delivered. Loads of people gave me amazing recommendations, and they told me that Leaflet is this JavaScript library that can take the GeoJSON data, so that's the data of the geographic shapes, and turn them into another type of JSON, a topo JSON, that works on the web, because GeoJSON is huge files, and obviously you don't want someone downloading huge files just to you know, look at a website. You want like your Google Maps equivalent to be, you know, almost instant. You don't want them to be sitting there for hours downloading tens of gigabytes of data. So I followed all the different tutorials, and I'll show you the result. So let's just make this full screen. So this is what the website looks like. And Brad's idea was essentially to have people able to zoom in on both maps at the same time. So that's Nebraska, for example, the one I was showing you in the slides. And you can see this is our solution, and this is the one in the real world. And you can also, obviously no one, I assume no one in this room lives in the US, but you can just make up whatever, an address. Oh no, am I offline? Let's try. I guess it's because I'm giving a talk that it's not working. But yeah, you can zoom in to a state, let's say this one, Michigan, and see exactly how good or bad where you live is. So if you live here, you can see there's some really gnarly shapes, whereas in our our solution, they're a lot simpler. So it's you can inspect two maps. And also what I said about asking people if they prefer the existing solution versus the clustering solution. So we ask people to select which state they're from. So let's just pretend to be from New Mexico. And then you get the two maps. So this is the current New Mexico districts. It looks like New Mexico has three districts. It doesn't look that bad, but I guess, yes, something is definitely going on there. I assume that this is the capital of New Mexico will be here, and they're trying to dilute the votes. Whereas in our solution, there's like one urban cluster. So let's say we prefer the clustering solution, and we click submit, and it says thank you, and the data appears in a Google form. I connected the two up. That was something else that I had to figure out for this project. And if we scroll to the very end, that's us right here today. That's what I just clicked. So it knows that we're in London, it knows the country, and we prefer the clusters, and we chose New Mexico. It even knows our postcode, EC2B. So that's the website. So that was all pretty much people on Twitter pointing me in the right direction and me just trying to figure stuff out. So the general lessons that I've learned from this experience, because I feel like I've learned a huge amount, but in the most abstract sense, is that Twitter can really direct you towards appropriate solutions. So no one pretty much wasted my time when I asked for how to solve the different problems. So it wasn't that everyone threw ideas at me and I had to choose one out of many, you know, mediocre ideas. Pretty much everyone pointed me in the right direction and saved me loads of time. I even ended up going in a chat room that was run by the US census people in order to understand the data, and actually just got on Skype and talked to a person that worked at the US Census Bureau. So I really received tons of very specific and useful help. It really teaches you that you can figure out who to ask, so you can actually get to the point where you're talking to someone who works for the US Census Bureau in my case. And in general, the online open source, open data, open science communities are extremely helpful, and openness in general really does promote being able to go from I knew nothing, absolutely nothing about GIS. I didn't even know that longitude and latitude, I obviously knew it, but not consciously. I didn't even know that longitude and latitude are two, it almost looks like they're 2D, but obviously the globe is 3D. So I didn't even know really basic stuff about how to do this GIS stuff. So they really help you out, and I really recommend joining Twitter if you don't have a Twitter account, and at least watching these exchanges and debates. So yeah, thank you very much, and any questions? Yeah.
You had to rewrite the whole K-means algorithm.
Sorry?
You had to rewrite, to recode the whole K-means algorithm. Aren't they,
I didn't hear the last bit. I had to rewrite the whole K-means end?
Algorithm.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Is there already some...
Yeah, there's already K-means, but I have a computer science degree, it's not my problem. So yes, there's already K-means, but when you want to... So this is a general piece of advice. When you want to create something very bespoke that doesn't exist in the world, there's generally two routes, which is the code and you modify it. And the other one is that you still use Stack Overflow, so you're still basing everything you do on stuff that other people have done as much as possible, but you write essentially your own piece of code. The pros and cons of the two options are very specific to what's out there. So if you want to write your own k-means and you go and look at a Python library, say scikit-learn k-means, you cannot monkey patch that or hack that in any realistic way. So if you go into the scikit-learn k-means and modify it in situ, for example, like where it sits on in your system library, just go into that file that has the k-means and copy paste it and make another k-means with a different name. Or something like that, it's very likely that the overhead of what you need to learn to understand how to actually make this modification is longer than just writing it from scratch. And if you've edited it in the way I just said, and you update scikit-learn on your system to the next version, it's gone. So there's a lot of things that you need to be aware of in terms of hacking around with other people's code, and it all depends on the specific case.
I now understand why you need a really powerful computer on your desk. Why I'm very pleased with that. I wonder, has this had any take-up? What's been the impact in the real world?
Yeah, so we've been trying to get, so there is an archive paper preprint out there already. It's been out there for, 6 months maybe, a while. We haven't managed to get it published in any journal so far. I would say the principal reason is because this isn't really a coherent area of study. So there's some people who are doing work, and they're doing work completely outside academia. So they create their own software and they post it on their own websites, but they don't write papers about it. And then there's people who are mathematicians, applied mathematicians who do literally just coming up with maths behind explaining, for example, why this shape is gerrymandered versus another shape, right? And then there's another group of people who are lawyers and political scientists who try a different tactic, so more like debating the legality of these maps. And because these three areas are almost by definition not overlapping, what we've done is kind of a combination of all three in some senses. I think it's quite hard to show the fact that it's, there's one group of people that don't publish, it's quite the people doing stuff outside academia. There's one group of people who are more like computer science, maths people, they won't normally do preprints or whatever journal proceedings. And then there's the political scientists who write like the more theoretical take on it or the legal take on it. And I don't think there's a easy way. But yeah, hopefully it will get published.
And then you'll see it's all out there in the world already.
Yeah.
And you've been speaking to the Census Bureau. I guess they're not responsible
they're
for
not,
this.
Yeah, so, yeah, yeah, yeah. So my friend at the US Census Bureau, they're not really allowed to take, they're civil servants, right? So they're not really allowed to take like a political, within their role, they're not allowed to express political views.
Change in creating those, or it's your like that.
as you probably know, people tend to like living with people that are like them. So you'll be like, oh, I'm moving to London because I can't stand where I am. I want to be somewhere that's more, whatever, multicultural and all these things. So people, in some ways, self-gerrymander, right? So they want to go and they move into urban, people who want to be in urban areas move into urban areas. People who are like, oh my God, I can't stand this, whatever. You know, they have issues. They go and they live whatever in Kent, right? So I think you can't stop that from happening because obviously people can live wherever they feel like living. So when you create these, when I created those maps, I didn't take into account what the people would be predicted to vote for, which obviously you could do and then have, you know, show, oh look, Trump wouldn't have won, right, or something like that. But the thing is, if you take into account how people vote in order to draw the lines, you start getting into this kind of much more corrupt way of doing it, which is like how they do it now. So what I feel is, for me personally, what I feel is the fairest thing is to just come up with, say for example, people who live in the same district should be no more than 20 minutes away by train or whatever, by public transport from the district centre. You can use this, so it would end up being quite often like a star shape, right? Because people live along fast lines into the centre of their district. And then what happens is, if the people who all, whatever, want to be the same, live together, at least in that case, they end up having a representative that can really strongly represent them. But like you say, it does end up being that people, especially in urban areas, self-gerrymander. But in some ways, I would say that like safe seats, where the seat is safe, not because of gerrymandering, but because the people who live in that area overwhelmingly support their candidate, are a truly democratic example, I think. So, yeah, obviously there's people who don't like the idea of self-gerrymandering, but I think it's absolutely fine. Yeah.